صلوات على محمد وآل محمد. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. وإذا لقوا الذين آمنوا قالوا آمنا وإذا خلوا إلى شياطينهم قالوا إنا معكم إنما نحن مستهزئون. الله يستهزئ بهم ويمدهم في طغيانهم يعمهون. أولئك الذين اشتروا الضلالة بالهدى فما تجارتهم وما كانوا مهتدين. مثلهم كمثل الذي استوقد نارا فلما وتركهم في ظلمات لا يبصرون. صم بكم عمي فهم لا يرجعون. أو كصيب من السماء فيه ظلمات ورعد وبرق فيه ظلمات ورعد وبرق يجعلون أصابعهم في آذانهم من الصواعق حذر الموت والله محيط بالكافرين. يكاد البرق يخطف أبصارهم كلما أضاء لهم مشوا فيه وإذا أظلم عليهم قاموا. ولو شاء الله لذهب بسمعهم وأبصارهم إن الله على كل شيء قدير. صدق الله العظيم. صلاة
Thank you for that. It was beautiful. Assalamu alaikum, everyone, and a very good evening to you all. My name is Sara Yusuf Ali, and I have the pleasure of being your host for tonight's fun-filled event. Let me take this opportunity to welcome you to this highly anticipated event. The whole purpose of this event is to enhance community spirit and make us all initiate discussion about the role of our culture and language in society. The highlight of today, of course, will be the debate with the motion that this house believes the Khoja mother tongue has no future. Fatakra futuanache aje. I'm thoroughly looking forward to hearing both sides of the story for what should be a really interesting debate. On a serious note though, you have to admit, speaking Gujarati with the Brahmi accent sounds hilarious. Let's just wait and see. We'll save the embarrassment for later. Anyway, we'll see. This should be easy. I'm gonna ask you all a question, okay? Apra Islamic calendar ma, apra Sauti Kushino Diwas kya manaweche? What is the most celebrated day by Muslims in the Islamic calendar? Anyone? Eid, okay. So the second question is, what is the Arabic word that you respond with when asking for something or someone? So once you've done your hajat, what's that Arabic word that you respond with? Anyone? Ameen, okay. Yeah, you guys are great, okay. So when putting the two together, tell me who was the president of Uganda in 1972 that ordered expulsion of his Asian country's minority? Wow, I'm gonna have so much fun with you guys. Okay, so I'd like to call upon Zulfikar Anka, who will be giving us a speech about the Ugandan exodus.
MashaAllah, people remember me with that. It'd be fantastic, you see. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Assalamu alaikum. I'm going to read something what I've written. I've been told to join two things together, Exodus from Uganda to how we settled in Birmingham and how we built this Imam Bargah. I'll give you in very short snips, because I haven't got enough time. They've given me a reasonable amount of time, but blessed we are all sitting in this Imam Bargah, a vision of young and old who had arrived in Birmingham, forced out of Uganda in 1972. I will give you a little brief on Uganda, then I'll give you a little brief on how the community got built here, and then part three would be the vision. The part one from Uganda coming here is my own version of it. Everyone who came from Uganda have different versions, different things they have seen. So I will start off from part one as a Uganda. Very fertile, beautiful country. Unfortunately, politically unstable. After the takeover by General Amin, few months after, Jews or Israelis were forced out to leave within 7 days' notice. Then came all the British passport holders, Asians, all the Asians forced to leave within 90 days. If we didn't leave, our lives would be in danger. We were told that we'd probably be killed. We had to come out with what we could, mostly our clothing in a suitcase. All monies, assets, family heirlooms, all were left behind. Cars, businesses, everything. My family of 10, my father, mother, brothers and sister, all 10 together, we came with £99 in our pocket, given by Ugandan government bank. Everyone was in panic in Uganda. British High Commission drafted a few more staff to get visas done and give everybody time to get out of Uganda. When we were coming out, to the airport, we saw quite a lot of, unfortunately, dead bodies around the side, on the sides of the roads. There were checkpoints everywhere. Every half a mile, the army would have their own rules and regulations. Oh, this can't be taken. What are you doing here? Why are you going there? And things like that. No law. We reached the airport. Customs started checking us. They wanted money or jewelry were taken away from ladies. Everything was taken away, put it in a basket. Okay, you go. We had a couple of Ishnashi families with us, Mirali, Mandaliaji Mirali's family. We're in the aircraft together. We came all. Flight took place, landed in Nairobi, sign of relief. Then we landed up in UK. I, with my family, we ended up in a camp called Stradishaw. It was an old army barrack. We had houses there. We were given a facility of clothing, food. After all that, there was an office there, we were given a choice of moving towards other counties in UK or other towns or cities. The council from this Birmingham or Solihull, where we went, ended up. Solihull councillor had come up in Stradishaw and given us a choice that there is a couple of houses for you. So we ended up in Solihull. My uncle previously had already come to Solihull. He was already working, Abdul Kimji. He was working and he had a car also. He had bought a car. And he came to the camp, brought my father here and showed him Solihull and Birmingham. My father liked. So we all ended up here in Solihull. After that, my uncle and myself, we started moving. Every weekend, we used to go to other camps looking for friends and families to bring them to Birmingham. Now, in Birmingham, we had 3 Ishnashi families guaranteed here. Remtula family, we had Welji family, we had Mitani family, 4 families, and Fazal family. Those 4 families were here. Unfortunately, I didn't know Mitani family or Fazal family, but we knew Welji family. So we went to them, we met them. Shabir Bhai's father had recently at that time died. So there was small majlises taking place. And the first majlises we attended was Welji's family, Afzal Welji's father and mother, Sharif Bhai, Hussain Sharif Bhai. We used to take out the settees from their back room, put it in the garden, and sit down and recite a majlis there. That was the first humble beginnings of our community. 4 families, 5 families. I got, in 73, my wife came from Kenya. They called a parcel bride. So that was our first parcel bride from Kenya, you see. And the delivery was from house to house. So from our house, from my uncle's house to our house, you see. And the family who attended was Fazal family. Welji family only, because nobody else was there. There was no community. Then we started, gradually everybody started gathering here. One after another family started coming in. Lots of people, lots of families started. We had first president elected at that point. We elected the first president, Rajwalibai. And all the families, Walji's, Hussein Bhai Walji, Somani, everybody started coming, and there were quite a lot of us actually. And we started hiring halls and places like that to do our religious ceremonies. We realized that we need Imam Barga. So that time people gathered together and we bought Forest Road, which didn't work out. I'm going very fast because I've been given a time limit there, you see. And from there, council gave us this land and we started building, mashallah. The hard work was to collect money. I will give you one example of a person whose name is here. Ghulam Sen Bhai. I don't know if you know the name. I haven't got a full name, but it's Ghulam Sen Bhai. Rachid Mehra. Thank you. Ghulam Sen Bhai used to walk around the streets, and he had a trolley. I don't know if anybody of you know this person or if you know about him. He used to take a trolley, go around the streets, collect aluminium cans. End of the day, he would take it to a recycling center, sell it, collect money, keep it to himself. Everybody was trying things for themselves. They were giving money, donations were coming. This person stood out for me, because what he was doing was something. Somebody asked him, says, "Tame shun karo cho? Maro rasto karu chu." That is what he used to say, "Maro rasto karu chu." You know how much money he collected and donated? The amount, I haven't got the exact fixed amount, but I remember it is from, no, you're not right. The amount he collected was from 24,000 to 30,000 pounds. That was the community spirit. That is what we call a community spirit. A little version or vision we have to have for how we go along. We are blessed with those people who built this, who put the effort in. I hope they are getting abundance of sawab jari. I would like you to put your hands together and recite Surah Fatiha for all those mahrumin who have passed away, and some of us still are here. Not Fatiha for us, but dua for us. Al Fatiha. Muhammad wa ali Muhammad salawat.
Thank you for that, Zulfikar uncle. I appreciate that many of our community members have gone through this journey. It's quite amazing to see what happens when power ends up in the wrong hands. For our next talk, before I call upon our next speaker, I am going to use one of my favorite movie quotes to introduce this country, okay? So you have to tell me what movie I'm referring to, okay? Relax, everything gonna be okay. Anyone? Relax, everything gonna be okay. Where have I got that movie quote from? Yeah, okay. I'm talking about the beautiful country of Somalia. Please welcome me in joining Sadiq Uncle Muraj, who will be delivering a talk on fleeing Somalian war. Also, if I can ask everyone to move forward, please. So this space at the back.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بفضل بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ربي اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. Respected elders and my all community members, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. First of all, let me introduce myself. My name is Sadiq Ali Muhammad Hussain, known as Sadiq Muraj. I have migrated from Somalia, and I'm here in Birmingham. Let me tell you something about Somalia. Somalia, the beautiful place, which we used to call in Gujarati, Jannat no Tukro. Our forefathers migrated to Somalia in 1880 as spice merchants. And we all had our businesses over there. We had our businesses for 110 years. Long time, more than a century. Well, now the war started. It was called a civil war, but it was a tribal war. It was between tribes, and still the thing is going on. I'm from this tribe, you are from this tribe. This is your territory, that's my territory. Everything was going like that. The war started on 28th of December, 1990. In the afternoon, 3:20 p.m. When the first bomb fell on the capital city of Mogadishu, I was having a power nap. I was sleeping at that time because in Muslim countries, we all know that the shops open in the morning, we get rest in the afternoon, and then start working again at 4:30 until 8 o'clock in the evening. And well, my wife came to me and says, Sadiq, we don't have kerosene. There are no lights. I said, my God, it's done now. I ran outside and went to the nearest shop to get kerosene. But there was a long queue over there. I saw an old lady standing in the queue first. I said, please help me. I'm going to pay for your kerosene. Can I give you my jerrycan to fill it? She said, yes. Are you going to pay for mine? I said, of course I will. I did that. Now the war started. We were living in a commercial area, a business area. The shops were downstairs and our houses were up there. At night, the rebellions were coming to loot the shops and they were firing on the gates of the shops. Me, my wife, my four kids, my mom and dad. Me, my wife, and my four kids were sleeping on one double bed. My kids were clinging with us. They were scared because if they hear some noise, the rebellions would shoot on the window. This was the situation. Then we had an incident. A young lady was killed. She was mentally retarded. The rebellions went to their home. They tried to snatch her necklace, but she shouted. And they showered her with the bullets. and she was finished there. We did not get time to take her to bury in our cemetery, which was very far from the place. So we buried her in the sahan of our mosque. The second casualty was a young man called Marhum Jafar Muhammad Raza Suleiman, who was married only 9 months. His wife was pregnant. He and his father were standing on the window looking at what was happening over there, and then they saw that he was no more. I myself was under the gunpoint several times. For what? For a single bucket of water. Not for some precious things. Then, luckily, we had an angel in Mombasa called Sajjad Bhai Rashid, our savior, the Noah of the century. He came with the ship to Mogadishu. And then we all went to the mosque. We got news that the ship is there ready on the harbor. But there was no time for us. We all went to the mosque, and from the mosque, we all went to the harbor. I was in the volunteers group. At that time, I was 30 years old, full of energy. Me, with my 10 young colleagues, were helping people from the boat, from the harbor to the boat, and from the boat to the ship. Because the ship could not come to the harbor, the people were firing. And when I reached the ship, it was 6:30 in the evening. Tired. Well, it was a long story. As they say in Urdu, Dastaan gham taveel hai aur waqt mukhtasar hai. Dastaan gham taveel hai aur waqt mukhtasar hai. Kabhi fursat mein baith ke guftagu karenge. Walhamdulillah rabbil alameen. Thank you very much for those people who have organized this session.
Just for information, it's just a little. Shadiq Bhai's travel in that ship had my two brother-in-laws volunteered from Mombasa also. Husna's brothers were in there, if you remember, Murtaza Kaku.
Exactly.
And Salim Kaku.
They both were in Sajjad Bhai Rashid's team.
Their Babi also was there. Husna's Babi was there.
Yeah.
So our community should have that spirit, you see.
I'm really thankful to all the people who helped us physically, and all the people, all the community who helped us financially to reach. I am here now. Sometimes people are asking me that what happened? You have seen many trials and tribulations. You came from Somalia to Kenya, and now you are here in Birmingham. I only say one sentence to them. فانوس بن کے جس کی حفاظت ہوا کرے وہ شمع کیا بجھے جسے روشن خدا کرے فی امان اللہ.
That was a chilling and awakening story indeed. Thank you for that, Sadiq Uncle. How many of us grew up in a household where we come back from school and there was a no English at home rule? Or when sitting on the table, telling our parents about our day, they say, Sambar, mene English na thi awetu, Gujarati ma bol. I was blessed with growing up in a household where, because of my parents' strict no English at home rule, my Gujarati isn't too bad, I think. But I think it started off with saying things like, Salam, Mom. Tu kevo che? And Papa, tu bo sorry che. But thankfully, that's significantly improved. Okay, so for the most awaited and highlight of tonight, it's time to move on to the debate. I'm going to call upon Ali Faza, who will take over and outline the rules for us.
Assalamu alaikum, everyone. Thank you very much, Sarah, and thank you everyone for coming. It's such an amazing turnout. Thank you all for being here today. Very intriguing talks by Sadiq Uncle and Zulfikar Uncle, so thank you for those. So I'm Ali Faza, and I have been given the opportunity to chair today's debate, so I'm very much looking forward to that. And I'll quickly run past the rules and the etiquette for today's debate. But before that, we've got good old Slido on the screen. So could everyone get their phones out, get onto slido.com, put down the code, hashtag COMM spirit, come spirit, and vote. And there's a question on, and this is based purely on your own opinion, your personal views, nothing else, just your personal view. And the question is, do you think, as a person, individually, do you think the Khoja mother tongue truly does have a future? So if you can cast your votes there, that'll be great. And I'll give you a minute to do that. And I'll do it myself as well. Okay, 1 second. Hassan is just sorting that out. So what we'll do is we'll call up the speakers before, and oh, is it up? Okay, it's up. Okay, so let's finish this and then we'll get the speakers up for today. I'm sitting there. Okay, nice. Okay, so we'll call up our speakers and I'll just take a seat now. All right, so, you can take a seat. Okay. I was going to call them up, but that's okay. Okay, perfect. So the motion for today's debate is, this house believes the Khoja mother tongue has no future. Speaking first for the proposition is Muhammad Abbas Jivraj. Muhammad Abbas has lived in Birmingham for just over 6 years. He currently works as a pharmacist, and in his own words, he's participating today because he loves speaking on the bomba. And I'm sure he'd be happy to give you a definition for that word. More importantly, however, Muhammad Abbas feels that language forms an integral part of someone's identity, and therefore he felt it would be interesting to debate the future of our inherited languages. Speaking first for the opposition is Sayeda Moti. Sayeda is a 16-year-old first-year college student who is currently studying philosophy and religion, psychology, and French. She has experience in performing in public as she's a cast member of Radiatullah Theatre, an Islamic theatre group which holds a national tour every year. She likes to think of herself as highly opinionated. Second speaker for the proposition is Sumeya Hemraj. Sumeya is currently studying chemistry, biology, politics, and drama at Camp Hill Girls. She enjoys netball almost as much as she enjoys debating a controversial topic, and she's very much looking forward to winning this one. Second speaker from the opposition is Shahnawaz Hassa. Shahnawaz is a 31-year-old businessman from Birmingham. Shahnawaz studied law at King's College London and qualified as a solicitor, specializing in mergers and acquisitions. Shahnawaz is heavily involved in community work and served as the World Federation Secretary General for 4 years. He currently co-owns a pharmaceutical group which offices in the United Kingdom, Germany, and Africa.
He's married with two children. Third speaker from the proposition is Karar Somji. Karar is a practicing solicitor advocate currently working at a niche litigation practice in Sutton Coalfield. He's the Jamaat's current electoral commissioner and is an active participant at the Jamaat general meetings. He was one of the founding members of the Africa Youth Network back in 2002. Originally from Arusha, Tanzania, he has lived in Birmingham for the last 15 years. And lastly, the third speaker from the opposition is Ifatanti Rajbhai. Ifatanti is a mother of three. She's NCSE qualified in counseling skills and is also an early years childhood practitioner who has been working at the English Martyrs School for the last 20 years. She's a prominent member of the community and is chair of the Mohammadi Nursery. Ifatanti says that one's mother tongue, open quote, is very, very important to learn from childhood, close quote. And she wants the community to know that. And so those are our speakers for today's debates. So now I'll quickly run through the etiquette and the rules and how it's going to work. So each speaker will have 7 minutes to deliver their speech. The first minute of their speech is protected time. Once the first minute of their speech is over, I'll sound my gavel once. Once I've done that, it means the protected time is over and the opposing team can raise a point of information. Points of information are a feature of a parliamentary debate, which allow the opposing team member to offer a brief point during the current speech. And you'll see how it works if you don't get it. The speaker who's speaking can decide whether to accept or reject the point of information. So at the end of protected time, which is 1 minute, I'll sound my gavel once. After 6 minutes of the speech, I'll sound my gavel twice. And at 7 minutes, once their speaking time is over, I'll continuously sound my gavel until they stop speaking. Perfect. So after that, we'll have 15-minute contributions from the crowd. You can ask questions, suggestions, ideas, anything you like. And finally, we'll finish with summary speeches from the proposition and then the opposition. Now, at the back of the hall, can I call up our reviewers for tonight's debate? So we have, firstly, Sheikh Nuru, who is going to be reviewing today's debate for us. Salawat. Allahumma salli ala. Can I call up Nikatanti Panjwani if she's here? Oh, yeah, there she is. Salawat. Allahumma salli ala. And last but not least, can I call up Adam Kimji? Allahumma salli ala. And they're very known faces. I don't think they need an introduction, so we'll get right to it. So without much ado, I would like to call this session into order and invite onto the podium our first speaker from the proposition. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome Muhammad Abbas Jivraj.
Ladies and gentlemen, salamu alaikum. As Karar mentioned very aptly in our video, a debate only takes place if there is some uncertainty to debate about. If our mother tongue had a future, or it was guaranteed, we wouldn't be here tonight. To understand the context and purpose of this debate, I think it is absolutely essential that we revisit the definition of the mother tongue, because the mother tongue does not necessarily mean the languages our parents spoke, or by extension, their parents did. So I did some digging deep and found different definitions which I'd like to present to you tonight. The Cambridge Dictionary defines the mother tongue as the first language you learn when you are a baby. Now, given that language is defined by the same dictionary as a system of communications by incorporating words, sounds, emotions, are we going to say that those sounds we made at 6 months old is our mother tongue? Or is there a deeper understanding to this? Some may argue that the mother tongue should be that language which we can read and write in which case we may as well just close our bags, leave. We may as well be celebrating Man United's victory today because more than 80% of us do not read and write in Gujarati. Or is it that language in which we think, because I don't think ek and ek is be. I think one and one is two. Then I looked at another dictionary, which is the Oxford Dictionary, one of the most highly revered dictionaries in the world. And that defines the mother tongue as the language that a person has grown up speaking from early childhood. This raises even bigger questions. Is it Urdu for people in Pakistan? Is it Gujarati for people in Gujarat? Is it Kachi for those in Kutch? Is it Kiswahili for those from Tanzania and Kenya? Is it French for those from Madagascar? So as we can see, this concept is quite huge. There are various definitions. There is not one definition. And the point I'd like to make here, I'll come to that in a bit. But for the purpose of this debate, I'm going to make a use of the Oxford Dictionary definition, which is the language that we have grown up speaking from early childhood. Given that we live in the UK, English is predominantly spoken for major parts of our day. We think in English, we associate in English, and I feel that there is an absolute need to review what our mother tongue is or should be. The point I'd like to make now is the mother tongue should not be restricted to those inherited ancestral languages of ours. Rather, it should be an evolutionary concept which relates to the times we live in.
Point of information. There is no clear definition. Point of information. Point of information.
I'll come to that later. Now, a number of people, including Sean, will disagree with me, but nobody will disagree with the Holy Prophet in this hall. And let's look at what the Holy Prophet did. So his ancestor, Prophet Ibrahim, spoke Aramaic and Hebrew, according to some historians. Yet the Holy Prophet decided to choose and speak Arabic because that was the language of the time. Are we saying he decided to forsake his mother tongue?
Point of information.
This is because Arabic was most widely spoken at the time. And he knew that he could address a wider population using Arabic. Now, my dear team opposition chose to do that quite well. In their video, they chose to use English to address to us why Gujarati is so important.
Point of information.
I am going to leave upon. So I am going to leave this upon to the upon the crowd and the judges to ponder upon and really think: are we really debating
this? Point of order. When we have a point of. Exactly. You have
sorry,
to either accept or reject. Okay, you cannot
I'm going
ignore.
To reject, sorry.
You've ignored already ignored definitions. You cannot ignore me.
Sorry, I'm going to reject. So when I arrived in this country in 2006, so I'm quite a newbie in this country, this wise person from Portsmouth mentioned to me, Muhammad Abbas, you are now in the UK. Do not create a mini Dar es Salaam around you and live in that bubble. Now, some might think it is offensive, but it's not, because you know what? We live in a different country to Dar es Salaam. People have different culture in here. The language is different. And to be able to integrate and associate with these people, we need to have something in common. And this has got to be our language. Just like Salman al-Farsi did, when he moved from Persia to Medina, he didn't speak Farsi. He spoke
point
in Arabic.
Point of information.
Yes.
He did speak Farsi. In fact, it's very well known he was speaking Farsi at the
yes,
time of the Holy Prophet.
But he chose to speak Arabic predominantly because he could associate with people of the time.
Point of
I
information.
Reject. Okay, similarly, Bilal al-Habashi decided to adopt Arabic. Also, when our forefathers migrated from India and Pakistan to Africa, they lived in very close-knit circles, very close-knit communities. So Gujarati thrived because Asians were dominant in trade. Your customers were Asians, predominantly Gujarati and Kachi was spoken. However, later on, they chose to learn the local language so that they could associate with the people of the time. People from Somalia would say
would
their parents probably... Sorry, I reject. Yeah. So coming back to our forefathers, they learned the local language. And similarly, it is so important for us to be able to integrate and associate with people of our country more so than ever before because of the rise in Islamophobia. Sorry, I reject. More so now because of the rise in Islamophobia and the hostile view towards immigrants and people of ethnic minorities. In an ongoing research project conducted by the University of Manchester called Unity Out of Diversity, speaking English emerged as one of the most important parts of integration, this being the opinion from both ethnic majority and minority groups as well. We now live in a world very different to what our forefathers lived in. We need to associate with people not within this hall, but people within this country, people within this world. We live in cosmopolitan cities. Look at this hall. There are people of different ethnicities in here, for a start. For us to be able to be part of this one big society, we need something in common. Now, one could argue it could be Gujarati or Kachi, and rightly so, it could be. But it can't compare with English, can it? There are 2 billion English speakers in the world, only 70 million Gujarati speakers. That's merely 1%. The number of people living in this country alone is just half that of English speakers in India.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Mohammed Abbas. Thank you. Can I just confirm that any points of information raised must be accepted or rejected, cannot be ignored? Thank you. Can I now call up the first opposition speaker? Can I now call upon the first opposition speaker, Sayed Amoti, with a loud salawat?
Okay, firstly, why can't you associate with the people in this room and associate with the British society? You can know more than one language as well, you know. And the Prophet was Arab, that was his culture. We're Qajars, so we speak Gujarati, our mother tongue. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Ya ayyuhal nasu, inna khalaqnakum min dhakarin wa untha, wa ja'alnakum shu'uban wa qaba'ila lita'arafu. O mankind, indeed we have created you from male and female and made you peoples and tribes that you may know one another. Surah 49, verse 13. I believe that this verse is implying that communication amongst one's own people is essential. Now, the one aspect that interlinks Qajars internationally is our mother tongue. This is the one element that makes us Qajars. Now, you can either be like the proposers who have such disregard for preserving their identity and are willing to neglect their mother tongue, or you can support us opposers who will continuously persevere in order to maintain our language. We will not concede defeat. Dumari emoji, your choice. So I believe that we need to reform this community collectively, because only together can we do something.
Point of information.
Reject.
Point of information.
You're making me lose my thread, whatever.
Well,
and that leads me on to the next point. Reject.
Point of information.
The worldwide Qajar community can be likened to a dusty reject. Okay, so the thread of a thespi is like our mother tongue, and we are the communities around the world are like the beads. Now, what proposition are proposing is to sever the ties. Where will that leave us as communities, scattered, disjoint, disconnected? Whether they would like to admit it or not, they are condemning the concept of being a Qajar, not just Gujarati, not just our mother tongue. Reject. Our ancestors ensured the preservation of our language. Are we going to honor them, or are we going to dismiss it? The proposition, they think it's easier to just surrender. So he mentioned a point about integrating in society. Firstly, by me knowing my mother tongue, how is this preventing me from integrating into society? I know English, I'm not behind. Where is the logic in that? I believe it to be non-existent. Also, would you like a dictionary? Because integrate means to combine one thing with another to form a whole. So we would take something good from our culture and combine it with something good from society. I think they mean assimilate, to become similar, to liken ourselves to society, to become them. So are you suggesting that we reject Islam, we reject our values and principles? Are you suggesting we reject Islam, our values and principles in order to integrate in society? Our ancestors who moved from India, they moved to Madagascar, Tanzania. They integrated by learning Swahili.
Point of information.
Reject. They integrated by learning Swahili and Malagasy, but they still preserved that mother tongue, so why can't we? So I believe it's time for us to undertake a community project together. We have a new alim, inshallah, a new mosque, so let's have a new focus, a new start. I have a proposal, a 5-step action plan. Number one, let's encourage our elder members of the community to speak to their family in Gujarati at home. although this is a community effort, individual effort is also required. We must all be willing. We must work together, and the work must start at home. Secondly, let's hold classes, interactive family events that will bring the community together, and then we'll be working towards the end goal to preserve our mother tongue. Now, those pessimists out there who believe we won't be able to achieve that end goal, well, coming together, it will create that community spirit, community cohesion anyway, and it will bring all ages together. So either way, we will benefit from it. Number three, let's introduce elements of Gujarati into our regular programs. For example, give children the opportunity to give 2 minutes
point
speech.
Of information.
Reject. give a speech about anything they've learned, perhaps from the classes, to give them an opportunity to flex their Guji muscles. Number four, perhaps we should have camps in India. What better way to strengthen our connection with our origin? And finally, perhaps have some some lectures in Gujarati from time to time at mosque. Finally, I would like to say that Gujarati was the first language I learnt, and I knew it fluently. When I started school, I didn't even know English. And then I started learning English and started speaking more English and less Gujarati. And although I will admit that my Gujarati is not the best, although I can speak basics and understand most of it, but I want to change that, because I think it's such a shame, and I think that we can together change this. So finally, I would just I'd like to say that anything is possible, and I'd like to quote Sheikh Noor from his Juma Khutbah from this week, and I would like to direct this especially to the proposition, do not give up. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Saida. Good timing as well. Can I now call up the second speaker from the proposition, Sumeya Hemraj.
Assalamu alaikum, everybody. Okay, first things first. Saida, please, take a deep breath. It's okay. We are not rejecting our culture. First of all, you said that Gujarati unites all Kojas. For starters, some Kojas speak Kachi. Also, if Gujarati is our uniting factor, why did you not address us in Gujarati? Why did you speak to us in English? You also said, after you proudly declared that you can speak Gujarati, which of course is a good thing, you also said, I know English, I'm not behind. What does that say? This is a globalized world. Knowing English is being ahead. Knowing Gujarati is being able to communicate with under 70 million people. Also, you said something about rejecting Islam. I do not go to nightclubs, I'd just like to make that clear. Also, we're not rejecting Gujarati, we're saying it has no future. Let me finish my sentence. But we're also saying that if we are saying we're rejecting Gujarati is not the same as rejecting Islam. We have to draw distinctions between culture and language and religion. I'll take it later, thanks. I'd like to say the biggest problem with our mother tongue is the fact that we are not literate in it. We cannot speak Gujarati, we can speak Gujarati, we can understand it, but we cannot read it and we cannot write it. If we went to Gujarat just now, we wouldn't be able to read the road signs, for God's sake. How can that be our main language? If you look at other communities who are living in England, like the Chinese community, for example, every week they send their kids to a Sunday
school.
Please just let me finish my sentence. They send their kids to a they send their kids to a Sunday school so that they can learn how to speak, write, and read in Chinese.
Point of
rejected.
Information.
But this is a good investment.
Point of information.
Rejected, because China is a growing economy. Okay.
Point of information.
China is rejected. China is going to become another superpower.
Point of information. You're saying
rejected. I didn't accept it. Rejected.
Don't.
I am not saying that. And if you let me finish my point, you'd understand that. So Mandarin is going to be an important language. If our mother tongue, say for example, was Hindi, it would be understandable that we invest in it, because India is also a growing economy. 2 billion people speak Hindi. Less than 70 million speak Gujarati. Wait a second. And coming back to the point about the 70 million people who speak Gujarati, if you went to India and spoke to someone who lives in Gujarat, I highly doubt they'd be able to understand your Koja version of Gujarati anyway, to be honest. So the fact that we can't access literature and the fact that our vocabulary is very limited because of the fact that we don't have our intelligent discussions in Gujarati. We don't have our intellectual debates. We don't have our medical appointments in Gujarati because we don't know that vocabulary. It's only day-to-day language, it's only day-to-day communication that we use Gujarati for. The people who are literate in Gujarati, number one, are few and far between. They are all also in the elder generation, which brings me to my next point. Gujarati is preserved purely in the older generation. My generation only know Gujarati primarily in order to communicate with our grandparents. For the elder generations, Gujarati holds a sentimental value. For my generation, it doesn't. It doesn't hold a sentimental value, and it doesn't hold any obvious practical value either. So why would we invest the amount of time in it that we would need to invest for it to become useful to us?
Point of information.
Okay, well.
Do you have it? Yeah, accepted?
Yeah.
Do you have any sociological, anthropological, linguistic information which tells you that your culture will survive if your language doesn't?
Oh, that's actually my next point. Yeah. Okay, so I mentioned earlier about the distinctions between language and culture. Let's hold on a second. Let's ask ourselves a question. What is it that we're afraid of? Are we afraid of losing our language? Or are we afraid that the fact that we're losing our language is an indication that we're also losing our culture? Language is often associated with culture. But again, let's hang on a minute. Let's look at a dictionary definition of culture. The Cambridge Dictionary says culture is a way of life, especially the general customs and beliefs of a particular group at a particular time. The time reference is something I'd like to focus on for a second. Culture is always evolving. How can we lose something that is changing with us as we change? Other definitions say that culture is music, art, theatre, and literature. These are key parts of culture. If this is the case, if this is the definition that we go with, we lost our culture a long time ago. Nobody here practices Indian music on a regular basis, do they? So let's think about the general customs and belief part of this definition. We don't have Indian beliefs. We have Islamic beliefs.
And they came through our culture. Point of information, sorry.
1 second. Let me finish, please. Rejected. We don't wear saris. We wear abayas. We wear abayas and kanzus. We don't do sapatia, but we have flower girls. We have mendis, but we don't all kiss the bride. We have vanais, but we don't all do dandiya. Let's just face the facts. We are not a community that is dictated by culture. We are a community who adapts its culture to help its growth and its development. So why can we not adapt our language in the same way? What is it that we're afraid of? Don't worry. We are a community blessed with the teachings of the Ahlul Bayt. We won't stop learning and growing and developing as people if we stop speaking Gujarati. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Sameha. And before I call up our next speaker, I've just received clarification that according to parliamentary style debate, a speaker is only allowed to reject a maximum of 3 points of information. And so henceforth, speakers will only be allowed to reject a maximum of 3 points of information. And I'm afraid we have to change it because we are following parliamentary style debate. And I'm sorry we didn't know about this earlier. Thank you. No, we'll start from now. So yeah, thank you, Sameha. And I'd like to call upon the second speaker from the opposition, Shahnawaz Hassan, with a loud salawat.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ربي شهري صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in Surah Ar-Rum, verse 22, a fantastic ayah. Please understand this ayah. And of his signs is the creation of the heavens and the earth and the diversity of your language and your colors. Indeed, in that are signs for those of knowledge. I have three main points which I'm going to present before you. The first point is once our language goes, our culture, yes, the word is Sanskruti, will erode, and then our kom, amari kom, ibijase. And the second point I have is once our culture erodes, then passing our madhab to future generations comes into direct jeopardy. And the third point I have is that it hasn't gone. The boat hasn't sailed. It's not too late. Languages can and have been revived. My first point is that when language erodes, culture erodes. And I asked a direct question to the earlier speaker, are there any anthropological studies, any linguistic studies that tell you that when your language goes, your culture stays? The answer is there are none. Every top authority rejected. Every top authority in this area has said the opposite. Every authority will tell you that language is an expression of culture. Language rejected. Language is an expression of our values, of our cognitive thinking, of our belief structure. Sapir and Whorf, and I'll go through a few of them, recognize that the relationship between language and culture rejected. They say it is not possible to understand language without first understanding culture. They even go through various different types. And they tell us, and they took the example of a language called Hopi, a Native American language. And they said when Hopi left from the Native Americans, they said their values changed. They changed as people. They changed their beliefs. Dr. Fishman, who is the world's leading expert in this area, he says the most important relationship between language and culture is that when language goes from culture, almost all is lost. Take language away from culture, you take away its greetings, its curses, its insults, its praises, its laws. Everything from it goes.
Point of information.
It's sayings. So then what is left? What is left, Karar? Accept it.
I think the way it goes is I ask the question, you answer.
Yeah, thank you so much. Dr. Fisherman also tells us that community is bound by language.
Sean, we need. You have to accept this one.
Quickly, please, it's my time that's going. Yes.
Oh, it is. The question is, you're mentioning obviously that you're losing culture, but what are the statistical evidence?
I've just given you anthropological studies. I can give you studies, 60 to 70 essays I can provide you, one after one of authorities rejected. Dr. Fisherman tells us, and he looks.
Sean, you have to accept this one.
So many, I've accepted more. No, rejected. Dr. Fisherman tells us.
Sean, you have to accept this one. You have to. I'll stop time for the question.
Okay, yes.
And the last time you greeted someone as Gemcho?
Hi, Hamnaj, Gemcho, Majamacho, Bosaro. Please don't waste my time. Don't waste my time. Dr. Fishman, who is the leading authority, talks about diasporas like our diaspora, the Ismaili diaspora, the Bahori, the Koji diaspora. He says community bound by language is what sociologists call Gemeinschaft. It's called in German Gemeinschaft, that we belong together. We have something in common. We are tied together through language. When that goes, that community is lost. I'm not telling you, there are academics that tell you. Talk to academics like Jalil Zadeh, the leading Iranian anthropologist, who says when the Farsi culture goes, the Iranian culture will go, and the religion will also be affected. And that goes me on to my second point, that when language is lost and culture is lost, then our madhab will be lost as well going forward for future generations. Brothers and sisters, rejected.
Sean, you have to accept this one. I'll stop the time for the question. You have to accept this.
It's Farsi language, there is the Persian culture. There's a distinction there. Which
thank you.
Together.
You just told me language and culture are connected. Thank you. When it comes to point two.
It's a distinction that you're failing to make.
Yeah, Farsi language and Iranian culture. When the Farsi language is lost, the Iranian culture will be lost. Point number two is once our language is lost and our culture is lost, then our madham will be lost. Brothers and sisters, this is not my words. This is the words of our marja'i taqlid, Ayatollah Sayyid Sistani, who in front of me has said this and has said this to many a people. One of the quotations on the August 19, 2004, he told a group of Parisian Khojas. I'm not going to accept, reject. He said to them, Carry on your mother tongue.
You need to accept. I'll stop the time for the question.
Okay. But I mean, now I'm accepting everyone, so this has just become silly. Okay.
Can we mention some Gujarati texts or philosophical texts? With Farsi, there are plenty of philosophical texts, and hence that culture, that language will thrive.
Gujarati is the 22nd most spoken language in the world. Tame em na kyo ke Gujarati ne tame
How will our mazhab
I don't have text in front of me right now.
Our mazhab is Islam.
Yes.
The language associated with Islam is Arabic. Yeah. I don't see how our mazhab would be lost.
Actually, our mazhab is mainly through our culture. Yeah? Through our culture. Tame pote ja vancho tamaru book che ti indigenous speeches vancho. Ke tamara mazhab Shia itna shi mazhab tamne kevita maili pehla I vancho. Second point. This is not my point. This is from Sayyid Sistani. He says, ask the believers living abroad to carry on their mother tongue as well as their traditions and culture so that the religious attachment amongst the community can be transmitted from generation to generation. Not my words, Sayyid Sistani. Then what happened to other Shiite Nashiris? Let me give you examples. I'll give you an example of Khoja Wahhabi. Remind me that. Let me first give you an example of other Shiite Nashiris who left India at the same time as the Khojas and lost their language, lost their culture, lost their religion. Let's look at the ones who went to Fiji. Indian, Shia Ithna Ashri from India went to Fiji. Two generations. First generation, they lost their language. Then they lost their culture, and now they are Ahlul Sunnah. Then look at the Indian Shia Biharis. They left from Bihar. They lost their religion. First, they lost their language. They went to Caribbean. They lost their language. Then they lost their culture. They lost their religion. These are the ones on the 10 days of Muharram, they have the Hosei festival. Yes? Where they sing and they dance and they talk about a person called Hosei who was killed. They mean Imam Hussein. They are Shia Ithnashris like we were Shia Ithnashris. But they lost their language. They lost their culture. Now let me give you an example of Khoja Shia Ithnashris who have changed to Khoja Wahhabi. Last year, we took out people from Yemen, and we were in touch with people from Mukalla. Those Yemenis who we evacuated, who remain Shia Ithnashris, they speak Kachi. Those who do not and did not became Wahhabi. We have examples of Khojas who became Wahhabis from Mukalla. They don't speak our language. They have not connected with our institutions. They have not connected with our Jamaats. They became Wahhabi. Brothers and sisters, when you have a community from Lal Pearl to London to Los Angeles, if you lose your language, if you lose your connection to the community, you will fall and assimilate into the cultures that are there. If it's a French connection, you'll become French. You'll have the French assimilated concepts. If it's British, it's British. Portuguese, etc. And my third point is languages can be revived. Who says it's all over? Who says it's finished? Who says the game is done? Look at Hawaiian, extinct, come back. Look at Marathi. Marathi is spoken by 71 million people, but the numbers dwindled to 1 million in the 1930s. Look at Irish. In the late 19th century, it was almost gone. Now 1.8 million people proudly speak Irish. Look at Hebrew. Hebrew was dead for two millennia as a spoken language. Yiddish was there, but Jews didn't speak Hebrew. They only had sacred texts of Hebrew which no one read. But when Ben Yehuda brought back Hebrew with conviction, with his principles, with the idea of making a Zionist state, he brought back Hebrew, and now 6 or 7, 9 million people speak Hebrew. An entire state adopted Hebrew. So don't listen to this proposition team that it's all gone, it's dead, it doesn't affect our culture, it doesn't affect our religion, it affects our religion, it's out of time. It affects our religion, it affects our culture, and it affects the very essence of our thoughts. That is why, brothers and sisters, let us maintain Gujarati, and let us oppose this team with every conviction we have.
Thank you very much, Sean. Can I just change up one of the rules, actually? We've received some advice from a few members of the audience that points of information are becoming a slight issue. So what we're going to do is there can be only a maximum of three rejections, but the opposing team can only raise a maximum of 6 points of information. Okay? Three rejected. Accepted. Maximum of 6 on the opposing team. Thank you very much, Sean. Can I call up the final speaker from the proposition, Karar Somji? With a loud salawat.
I thought I'd bring the book with me in case there was any doubt.
Salamu alaikum. Bayo ne beno. Bacha, bachao ne mara buzurgo. Salamun alaikum. Second salam.
If I could mainly deal with, in my protected time, the points that Sean raised, I think he's missed the subject matter. We're not saying, let's give up Gujarati. Gujarati is lost. It can't be revived. The motion is the Koja mother tongue is declining. Has no future, sorry, my bad. It is declining. Well, it has no future. So it's not that there is a positive emphasis on losing the mother tongue. The emphasis is on what trajectory are we on at the moment. The trajectory, we say, is a downward trajectory. It's not an upward trajectory. Going on your own submissions that it can be revived, it's not lost, it's not gone, we can do something about it, shows a defeatist argument that we still have to do something about it, something positive to revive something that is, on their own submissions, perhaps
point of information.
Weak, rejected. Now, if I could come to my own submissions in terms of my own arguments for tonight. In terms of whether we accept the attitude towards mother tongue, it depends on perspective. Each individual person has a perspective on what the mother tongue is, how we preserve it, how it is preserved. A quote comes to mind. Everything we hear is an opinion, not fact. Everything we see is perspective, not truth. Marcus Aurelius, a philosopher. I leave you with a question. What is lost when a culture is dislocated when it loses its language that is traditionally associated with it? Now, the opposers say you lose your culture entirely. A main point comes to mind. If you, those educated in East Africa, know about the formation of Tanzania, Kenya, these were all tribal-based cultures. Each tribe had their own indigenous language. Those from northern Tanzania, Sara should know this, you have the Chagas in Moshi that speak Kichaga. You have the Bantus, you have the various tribes. The uniting factor in Tanzania is Kiswahili. Now, they will just jump at this and say, oh, that's it, that's Gujarati. No, what we're saying is these tribes maintain their own culture, they maintain their own belief systems and all that, but the written and spoken language, Tanzania has chosen it to be Kiswahili. Go to Kenya on the other side, you have Kiswahili, but they have predominantly chosen English as their language. As you encounter a Kenyan, you will see their command of English is a lot better, but Kiswahili, not so much. When they say, I'll turn the car, they say, ntapindua gari, I will overturn the car. Now, coming to my own perspective, because I mentioned mother tongue perspective. Growing up in Arusha, at home, we spoke Gujarati. I can't for one second imagine speaking to any other in any other language to my dad. If I spoke to him in English, it would seem alien.
Point of information.
Rejected. I'll bring you to your last three. So I'll give you your three. Coming to now, I have now us four siblings. So we're four siblings. We all speak Gujarati. My sisters have command of Kachi. Me and my brother have a good command of Gujarati. But amongst the family, we have seven nieces and nephews. Of the seven, only one has a very good command of Gujarati. The other six, English, Gujarati, tuteli. Have maripotam tamne daklo dam. Madrasa Gujarati mein loka sikharta tha. Ek divas week no Gujarati lesson hoye, ema Gujarati na akshar hoye, Gujarati lakhvanu. Ne ek mane hamna pachho mailu poem che, kavita ki apre, kavita? Ne kavitanu naam che bar imamo na ashar. Have khabar nahi kitla jano ne e kavitanu naam thi khabar pari jase. Bahut tamne ena panch kari pari ne daun chu. Rag ma nahi paru because maru rag nathi. Pan pratham ali bija hasan Hussein Trija Jan, Chotha Zainul Abidin, Panjum Bakarna. There is a certain element of this crowd, as soon as they've heard that, something will have awoken in them. They will have heard this before. At Madrasa, we used to perform this. This was an anthem that we used to recite. But in this crowd, the children that are here, a certain age generation gap, how many of us remember that or have heard it being performed? It's not being done. Your third one, rejected. Now you can throw good ones.
Point of information.
Go ahead.
The point of our debate is not whether it's dying or not. We want to preserve it. You're not bothered about it. That's the main point. We want to preserve it. We want to do whatever it takes because we understand how it's important for our culture, how it is important for mother. For you, it's not important. You're happy to put the culture, the language down the bin. Thank you.
Shan, read the motion title again.
I read it out to
therein
you.
Lies
I'm the one
your
who read
answer.
It to you.
Therein lies your answer. It says the Koja mother tongue has no future. When I started, I said it's the trajectory we are on.
Point of information.
Okay, go ahead.
No, it's okay,
so he's lost his second one.
Point of information.
go ahead.
The point is that the way the debate, first of all, against all rules, you've defined it with three different definitions. You need to come up with one very clear definition that wasn't done at the very beginning. The second point is that if it has no future, no, you didn't. Three defines. No, you can't, and you don't have a right to reply. The second point, which is a very important point, is we agree that we think it has a future because we believe it can be revived. The point is the revival of the Gujarati culture, Gujarati language, and the importance, the fundamental importance to our culture and the fundamental importance to our mother.
Shan, may I thank you for that question, because within it you said it can be revived. What do you revive? You revive something that is dead or dying. That is the point, right? Now, when you are reviving something, how are you living without it now? What are we operating on? What is the modus operandi at the moment? The modus operandi at the moment is our lectures are in English, not in Gujarati. Our lectures are in Urdu, not in Gujarati. So what do you want? The 5-week session that the Jamaat has decided to hold will somehow revive Gujarati? No, I don't think it will. The question lies in with us parents, well, those of us who are parents, to sit down and have a think about it. We will pass on some element or some proficiency of Gujarati to our children. Question is, will our children pass it on to their children? Will their children passing on to their own children? And that is what the proposition is saying, that in 20, 30, 40, 50 years' time, hand on heart, from what you're doing here today with your own children, will they have a sufficient command of the language to pass on? And on that basis, what the proposition say, we're not saying that it's gone. I love Gujarati. I'd love to pass it on to my children. If I had an ideal list of what I'd want my child to do, Gujarati would be one of them. But subconsciously, I think the community members have made up their mind. And this is where we need to finish up. Okay. This is where, as a community, we need to have a deep thought about this. The discussion, well, it started today. It started today, but I think the motion stands that it has no future on the status quo. It may or it can do, but on the status quo, it doesn't. What are we going to do about it? Thank you.
Thank you very much, Karar. And lastly, can I call upon the last speaker from the opposition, Ifatanti Rajbai, with a loud salawat.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. We'll try to say that if a patient is dying and you'll just leave it, let the patient die, of course you'll try to save that patient even if you've got a little percent left. So, inshallah, Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Mara wadilo tata behno tata bachao salamun alaikum. Hu auchu amari Gujarati thorik tame ed karu chu mari aje debate ma. Gujarati apre boj mehnat karine Gujarati zinda rakhvanu chhe, e apru culture chhe, e apru heritage chhe. To apre kem e akhu roots ne sau muki daye. આપણે ઇન્શાલ્લાહ નાના બચ્ચાથી હમણાં આપણે કોશિશ કરે, આપણે હમણાંથી કોશિશ નહીં કરીએ તો ક્યારે કરશું? તમે ઘરે જઈને તમારા બચ્ચા સાથે ઇંગ્લિશ બોલશો? યુ પેરેન્ટ્સ આર ધ રોલ મોડેલ્સ ઓફ યોર ચિલ્ડ્રન, લેટ્સ નોટ ફોગેટ ધેટ. બિફોર આઈ સ્ટાર્ટ માય ડિબેટ, વેરી ક્વિકલી, હાઉ ડીડ આઈ બ્રિંગ અપ માય ચિલ્ડ્રન? There used to be a house policy. If you want to talk to me in Gujarati, I had two mother tongues. Gujarati and I reject that. Gujarati and Kachi. All my children started speaking Gujarati and Kachi. How did they learn? You have to make an effort. You have to really work hard. As a role models of your parents, who are there to blame?
Information.
So I reject that. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. I will definitely say in English this time because I've said very little few in Gujarati. So I hope inshallah everybody understands that in English, but if you do not hesitate to ask me, I can speak five languages. You can anytime come and contact me because I've got very few.
Point of information.
That. The English Oxford Dictionary translates the terminology mother tongue as one of native language or a language from which other languages have evolved. If you look at, just reject that. If you look at the Khoja community, we are roughly 25,000 Khojas worldwide. An estimated one-third of us live in Western Europe and North America. The other two-thirds live in Africa, the Middle East, India, Pakistan, Madagascar, Australia.
Point of information.
I reject that. We all have mother tongue, but our mother tongues vary from country to country. We have Khojas, those who live in... We have those Khojas who live in Yemen. Those people who speak Kachi, their majalis is in Kachi.
Point of
we have just
if Atanti, you have to accept this one now, please, if you don't mind.
You're wasting my time, aren't you?
No,
my time is all gone. I've got a lovely speech to give.
Don't worry, the time is paused
the
for while he asks his question, and then
so we can have our discussion.
Yes.
Do you want to? Not the time. The question is a very simple one. Perhaps it's just a comment. If Atanti, I think you are the exception. You are not the norm. Can you deal with that in terms of your passing of your language to your children and the community at large?
Passing my language, what do you mean, like speaking?
In terms of conveying, teaching, I'm saying you are the exception, you are not the norm. How can you justify that? Are you saying everybody does it in terms of...
That's what you have to work hard on it. You have to try.
Like, you accept this is just it's not happening at the moment.
No.
You accept that.
No,
you accept
it is
that.
Happening.
It is happening.
No, it's happening. We have Khojas whose mother tongue, again, I'll repeat that, in Kutch. Those living and the Yemenis people still have majalises in Kutchi. Again, just to come to, we have Khojas from Zanzibar. The Zanzibari Khojas whose mode of conversation is Swahili. And if they choose to speak any other language, which will mix Gujarati, again, Kachi, English, everything they'll mix and they'll make a Kachumbo.
Point of information.
Or they will just make a Kichro out of it, but they will still pick their
point
mother
of
tongue.
If Atanti, this is the second one you have to accept, please, if you don't mind.
As you very relevantly mentioned, for the Zanzibari Khojas, they spoke in Swahili. Did their mother tongue not change that?
No, it hasn't changed. They still continue to speak that. And to go back to Zanzibar, they still speak the same language, and alhamdulillah, there's so much sweetness in that language. Most of our time, our community members, even they speak in Portsmouth, you'll see them speaking Swahili, and still they will take the roots, which is Gujarati and Kachi. Just to coming back to the Gujarati point, the mother tongue of the Khoja, they're allowed to give you a brief synopsis of a wonderful language around which our culture revolves. Gujarati, my friends, it is the 26th most widely spoken language in the world, all over the world. It is also considered opinion of a child psychologist that from the time a child is conceived and starts growing in the mother's womb, there exists a hotline of communication between a mother and a child via the mother tongue. The mother speaks to her child during the period. That is very first step with an unborn baby introduced to the mother tongue. When your child is in your womb, that's the time when the communication starts. Not only that, but after the childbirth, it affects all med country communicating with the child. If the mother tongue family bonds, especially between the generation, between grandparents and everybody, it becomes stronger and stronger. Let me remind you that child's first language is part of their personal, social, and cultural identity. A child who is bilingual or multi-bilingual has a solid grounding.
Point of information?
Both educationally, can I reject that? And culturally.
This is the final one you have to accept.
Can I finish that first?
Sure.
Maintaining first language is a vital, in conclusion, I say to you that it is cardinal duty of every Khoja household to ensure that the mother tongue of Gujarati, for that matter, Kachi, is taught to their children and spoken at home with appropriate and preserve the Khoja mode of communication. It's very, very important. Why should we give up our mother tongue? And there's so much sweetness in it. Yes, can I come back to your question?
Of course you can.
You mentioned that lectures and whatever should be in Kutchi to make it more.
My point was that in Yemen they speak Kutchi.
Okay, yes. And it was inferred that we should do the same. My point is, we are in a Jamaat in which our youth are already alienated. If we changed our lectures to Gujarati and Kutchi, how many youth do you think would, number one, understand, and number two, attend the lectures? We changed our lectures from Urdu into English to make it more accessible. If we change it back to Kutchi, are we not going back in progress rather than going forwards?
To be honest, you're asking me a question. Where did I learn Kutchi and Urdu? I didn't go to university. I didn't go anywhere. I sat near my mom and I was listening to all the lectures. So that's the way of moving forward.
Answer the question.
We can move forward if we want to move forward. You have to have a passion. You have to have that determination, and you have to have a confidence. Even just coming back to the, may I also remind that this eminence of Ayatollah Ali al-Hussein al-Shistani has time again emphasized on the importance of mother tongue, and the Mukalladin have been strongly advised Aga to teach mother tongue to their children. My speaker, I rest my case here and I say to that house, the Khoja mother tongue has a huge potential and a bright future. So why should we lead? Apre samate muki daye kai padi nathi gyu kai tuti nathi gyu daba ma haji pairu che to dabo kholi ne karo sikharo tamara bachcha ne tamara bachcha kyare sikse. So this is that. Thank you very much, Asan. Jazakallah khair.
Thank you very much, Ifatanti, and thank you all to the speakers for those very passionate and compelling speeches. So now we've come to the point of the debate where we open the comments and suggestions to the crowd. The floor is now open. So any points, any suggestions, ideas, or questions, just raise your hand and we'll get someone to come over to you. Sumaira, could you grab the mic for the ladies? And is there someone from the men's, the gentlemen's, who can take the mic and go around with it, please? Thanks, cousin. Oh yeah, perfect. Thank you. Okay, and if anyone has anyone with a comment or suggestion that would like to start us off, yes. Yeah, in the summer.
Assalamu alaikum, everybody. Firstly, with the mother tongue, we seem to be referring to mother tongue as Gujarati, whereas that's not the mother tongue of all Khojas to begin with. Secondly, there was some mention, I think, from Shan that the Farsi language was connected to the culture, which was then connected to the language, and then the loss of that would have been the loss of the religion. But in Iran, there's various religions, so there's nothing connecting that to the Muslim faith. The Hebrew faith was lost for 2 millennia, and the Jews didn't lose their faith. And if we're relating language to religion, then does that mean Gujaratis speak more holier? In terms of us getting our religion from Gujarati, actually, we've got Hinduism from there. It's our forefathers who made the shift, so it wasn't actually the language that gave us our religion. We encourage the losing of our culture in our weddings, and yet we seem to want to maintain it at other times. Karbala, we mentioned Karbala Imam Hussein. To be honest, the various people in terms of religion and culture in Karbala shows us that actually religion is beyond any culture and any religion. I'm wondering, the amount of energy, I think that's one thing that came across, the amount of energy that it's going to take to keep up the Gujarati language to a prominent position where you can speak it, read it, and write in it. Should we not be putting that energy in an Islamic culture? Because we're reading du'as, namaz, Quran, we don't understand it. How about we plow that energy into something like Arabic? And how about we preserve an Islamic culture we seem to be foregoing in favor of our Hindu culture?
Thank you very much, Aunty. Can I just suggest to everyone to please keep the point of information to a maximum of 30 seconds just so we can get through as many as we possibly can. Thank you. Anyone else? Just raise your hand.
Sorry, can you ask a question as well? Or?
Yes, please. Yeah. Please do ask. Yeah.
So the question is to Sean, if that's possible. Is that okay?
It's
okay. Yeah.
Yeah.
So you... So just one question was, so you mentioned some examples where we had sects who had lost their language and therefore lost their religion. So the question is, what's the data or the evidence to suggest that the loss of religion was because of the loss of the language?
So Sean will be able to answer that question during his summary speech right at the end. Thanks. Anyone else? Imran has a question.
Let Imran ask his question. Salaam alaikum. You think about why we should stop talking in English? Well, from my point of view is, since we have been talking in English for such a long time, and I have been doing it as well, why can't we just carry on with it?
Thank you very much. We have one just in front here. There.
Thank you very much. Sean, Karar, fantastic, inspiring speeches. Just coming back to the motion itself, the Khoja mother tongue has no future. I'd like to just revisit the definition. The mother tongue is the language in which we are brought up, in which we socialize, in which we interact, in which we worship. For the British Khoja, I'd argue our British Khoja mother tongue is English. And therefore, I'd suggest vote for the opposition to say that actually we do have a future for our mother tongue, but actually our mother tongue is actually English.
We have a comment from the ladies, and then we'll come to the back over there.
Assalamu alaikum. It's more of a comment. I feel a bit sad that we're ready to throw Gujarati out of the window. I've come from Paris. If it wasn't for English, for Gujarati, sorry, I wouldn't be married. Sayed, I wouldn't be sitting there for. I couldn't speak English, my husband couldn't speak French, so Gujarati was our link. My forefathers have left India the same way as people went to East Africa, Tanzania, and everything. My forefathers went to Madagascar. They settled there, they learned Malagasy, they kept the Gujarati. My parents then moved to Paris. They kept the Gujarati, they kept the Malagasy, and they learned French. Now I've moved to England, and I've kept my Gujarati, I've kept my French, and I've kept my English. So I don't see why it's not possible to do both. I don't know why we've left our community go so down. Yes, and I will say, I personally feel there's two factors are responsible for this. Number one is the families, like us parents. So if I don't speak Gujarati and I don't keep it up with my children, it's normal, they're not gonna speak it. And secondly, I feel it's our community, because the difference between East Africa and Madagascar was that the mosque programs were kept in Gujarati. Therefore, everyone from the youngest to the eldest knew how to speak and understand Gujarati, and there was no that break of generation between the youngest and the eldest.
Thank you very much. Thank you. We'll go right to the back over there, Sharia, if that's okay.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I just want to comment that the difference between learning a language, picking a language up and learning it, I think learning any language is a good thing. But I think the emphasis should be on education and learning. So when you're talking about like keeping the culture, keeping the language, the best way to do that is through actually teaching it and actually kind of like looking at vocabulary, doing courses and learning it that way, because too many of us think that we know a language and we can't string a sentence together. You know, so like doing GCSE, Gujarati language and things like that.
Fair point,
I would encourage that, and anyone who can like speaks that, who wants to know their own mother tongue, if it's Punjabi or if it's Urdu even, right, then they should pick up a
thank
book
you yeah very very fair point thing. Thank you very much. Thanks. Could we go over to the ladies? Is there anyone next door? Someone speaking from next door.
Who? Can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
You have no idea. I the audience they go. This. Hello?
Yeah. Would you like to move into the main hall for the question, please?
All right, I'm coming in.
Thank you. Okay.
Right, I'm here. Oh. Can you hear me?
Alaikum salam, auntie. Thank you very much for coming.
Right. Basically, I've been here for more than 50 years. When I came to this country was basically a Christian country. Few years back, about 15, 20 years ago, the wisdom from the government, they decided to take out religion from the syllabus of the school. Today, unfortunately, you see the results in the state school and compare to those schools which are still maintain religion studies. For instance, Catholic schools, Jewish schools, I don't know about Muslim schools, but at least those schools I know that they differ in that standard, in the standard as in general standard. That was number one. So if I think most of us here, most of you young people as well, you want to remove Gujarati. Enough, yeah. Remove it. So but today you see, Gujarati is a part of culture. There's history in it. Our language is our culture, yeah. Our identity. You will lose that identity. Like I said, 20 years ago, they removed the religion. There's no identity.
Point. So it's about identity and education.
Exactly,
yeah.
And you
lovely.
Need it,
thank
you see.
You, thank you so
and
much.
Nobody stops you from learning different languages. Nobody tells you not to learn. Yeah. Learn the more. Our religion tells you to learn more and
thank
more.
Thank you so much. I'm just going to have to say stick to 30 seconds if that's okay. Thank you so much for coming over to the other hall as well. Should we go over to the men's if that's okay? We have Alirza right to the back who's...
I think the distinction must be made also between culture and religion. So the Prophet was sent to an Arab culture. Hence, the language utilized there was Arabic. So that distinction must be made. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Should we go over here to Shaydanti? Yeah, we can.
You know, we are having this debate here. Okay, when we are having a debate here because we are not sure, okay? So where do we go to? We go to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say in the Quran? That Allah will not change the situation of people unless they change themselves. Okay, now, another thing is Najul Balaga. Okay, Najul Balaga, Imam Ali alayhi salam says, ask experienced old people who have been through experiences. Okay, so I'll tell you my experience. And the answer to Karar, you know, beautiful, you know, it was beautiful lecture that he gave, okay? He wants his children to learn Gujarati, okay? Now, from my experience, okay, 1980, my children, 80, 82, 84, okay, all three children speak full Gujarati. My youngest son, when he went to school, he was 5 years old, 4 and a half more, you know, and he can speak fluent Gujarati and English, okay. Nowadays, I'm telling you from experience, my grandchildren, okay, we started to speak Gujarati with them, but nowadays youngsters are frightened. You know why? Because they think that if they don't speak English with them, they will not learn in school. But that is not so. Another thing that you said was that the lecture on Thursday, when do we have lecture? Only once. Every day, if the parents speak Gujarati with them, they will learn.
Very, very fair point.
You know, and also, you know, it's a bonus.
Just 30-second timing.
Yeah, it's a bonus. People nowadays, they feel proud to learn other languages.
So it's about
it's
pride
a bonus, beautiful language.
Well.
Don't let us not throw
very
it away.
True. Thank
let
you so try. Much. Thank you so much for your comment. From the men's, should we go back to the men's? Anyone have a Zulfikar uncle right to the front? And we'll stick to 30 seconds henceforth, please.
Not 30 seconds on this one. I think I've got an answer for it. Hope so. Have you heard this?
In 30 seconds, please.
Well, I'll leave it then if you don't want to hear it. Little kitten was frightened because the dog was barking. Run away behind mommy cat. The cat started barking at the dog. And the dog ran away. The little kitten said to mommy cat, "How did you do that?" He says, "It is always nicer to know second language, you see." So this is how it
very,
is.
Very good analogy. Yeah,
we can have Kachi there or Gujarati there.
Yeah.
Arabic as a second language, play with English, but learn
very
Gujarati.
Very fair point. Very, very fair point. We'll have one from the ladies and then one more from the gents. Yeah.
Was that? Does have a future. If you look at prominent sectors now, I work in education, who works in the NHS, the number of times he's come home and said to me,
Very fair point. So a secular society doesn't necessarily mean just English. Good, very nice. Thank you very much. Should we go back right to the back to Uncle over there, and then we'll end there if that's okay. Sorry about that.
Assalamu alaikum. Yeah, I will just make a conclusion of this debate. I think there are three things here: religion, culture, and language. We have to admit here that our first language, whether we like it or not here, our children's first language, their mother tongue, is English. English and religion, and there is nothing to stop the religion of Islam to be propagated in English to our children. That is fine. But at the same time, our culture is associated with our language, with the Gujarati language. So in order to preserve our culture, we need to learn Gujarati. Yeah.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Uncle. Thanks for keeping it short and sweet. Can we finish off really quickly with Yasmin, auntie? I'm really intrigued to see what she has to say. So let's go quickly to her and then we'll finish off right there. 30 seconds, please. Okay. Very fair point. Thank you very much to all the contributions from the crowd, and I'm sure it's given the speakers a lot to think about. But now, without much ado, I'd like to call upon, in fact, I'll just outline how the summary speech is going to work. So now we'll have summary speeches from the proposition and the opposition. 5 minutes each speech. After 4 minutes, I'll sound the gavel once to let the speakers know they have 1 minute remaining. So I'd like to call upon Karar Somji for the proposition's summary speech.
No.
Oh yes, no points of information during the summary speeches. Okay. Also, just to let you all know, there'll be a vote right at the end, so this can be your time to decide what way you want to vote.
Wait, give me a second, let me set up.
Yeah. Just let me know whenever you're ready.
Let me set up.
Okay, where are we starting?
Ready when you are?
Lovely. Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, everyone.
In terms
Salawat for Karar Somji, who is this proposition's summary speaker.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad
wa Ali Muhammad.
In terms of the proposition summary of today's or tonight's debate, let's remind ourselves of the motion that I'd forgotten in my first speech. The Khoja mother tongue has no future. It does not say the Khoja mother tongue cannot have a future, will not have a future, should not have a future, does not have a future. Now, I mentioned a bit about perspective. Picking up the points that the crowd made, and they were very good and pertinent points that were made, picking up from Sukaina's initial point about Iran and Persia, the book that Sean mentioned that we both have and we're holding as a Bible, the book, obviously, the lack of empirical evidence leads the author to make to rely on conjecture, but it's conjecture that you can follow. Because obviously there is no empirical evidence of how much people have fluency and what the stats are. We don't conduct in-depth censuses in our community that deal with language, etc. But the conjecture is you can follow it. Now, one of the points that is mentioned within the book, and Sean will agree, that there was a community, that Khoja community, that migrated to Iran. They do not hold Gujarati in Iran. They have assimilated in society, and all they speak is Persian or Farsi. And again, that is another good example of, well, that is one outcome, and that's a decision that community made. Equally, yes, there is the community that went into the West Indies and West Africa. But equally, what we're dealing with is Khoja, the unique migratory path that our forefathers took from Kutch, coast of East Africa, and then beyond. On that point, finalizing the point of Sukaina, is that if we are going to employ resources, because again, there was talk of that from the opposers, that we need resources, we need to revive something, then are we not at a crossroads where we need to see, is it Arabic, is it Farsi, is it even English? There is that question mark. What is the mother tongue? Is it just Gujarati? Is it a mixture of various languages? Picking up from the point about what is spoken in Zanzibar, for those of you that have had the benefit or fortune to visit, when you sit at the baraza in outside Mamwaro, you hear beautiful Kiswahili. Watu wanaongea Kiswahili pale. You do not hear, well, you might hear a bit of Gujarati there, but the Zanzibari Kiswahili is just, it's unique. It's quite sweet, I'd say. So there you go. That perspective on the mother tongue is quite different in Zanzibar as it may be for those of you sitting in the crowd who grew up with English as their mother tongue. But I think initially, what has been defined as a Khoja mother tongue has a strong Gujarati influence. So we'll have to accept that for the basis of our answering our question tonight, that for what we've debated, Gujarati has to hold a certain weight onto it. Coming on to what we need to do, madrasa, point I touched on. Sean has done a lot of work with the World Federation. The World Federation is currently doing work on the Madrasa Center for Excellence. Where does Gujarati feature amongst it? In our policymaking, be it at Jamaat level, be it at Federation level, Gujarati is not being addressed. Yet here we are, passionate people, talking about the revival and keeping the language alive. Well, we need to be looking into our pantries and deciding what are we doing about it. Because as the proposition says, on the current trajectory, you will not have it. A good point made by one of the ladies was, I can speak in a broken language that I can communicate, and it's beneficial. Accepted. I accept that is better to have that than nothing. Equally, her children, her children's children, if you have something broken, how much of a piece will you pass on? Should you not start from a position of strength to then pass it on? I think I'll have to cut short my summary, but the opposition has used defeatist language. Gujarati ne zinda rakhvanu chhe apre. Gujarati ne apre pacho li aave. Batu barabar chhe. We have to employ resources, but the proposition is not saying leave Gujarati. What we are saying is be factual about it, be rational about it. Look at yourself and see, okay, I will pass it on to my niece, nephew, daughter, son. Will they pass it on? Have I passed on enough? What else should I be doing? There is a GCSE in Gujarati. How many of us tell our children, well, you must take that GCSE because I want you to pass on my tongue that my mother passed on to me. Dad, I want to do German. Dad, I want to do Mandarin. But mashallah. Mashallah tukari. Gujarati? I can speak it. I can speak it, and I'm proud of it, and I'd like to pass it on to it. But that's a good point, Sajjad, that having the desire to pass it on does not mean it will materialize. And let us be honest about it. Let us be honest about it. If I could just finish up, yeah. That I have the desire, and I do not deny that I have the desire, but I also have to accept rationally that it will also depend on my other half, and two, the condition I find myself in. And I fear that if I am to continue, if the community is to continue on the current trajectory, the motion is put to you, the Khoja mother tongue has no future. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Kar. And last but not least, Shahnabas.
A'udhu billahi minash shaitan rajim, bismillahi rahmani rahim. Brothers and sisters, our side of the house rejects the idea that our mother tongue has no future. They, too, also are not sure on what the definition is. They gave us three different definitions. But in essence, the bulk of their argument is it has no future because less people speak it, number one. And number two, which is an argument which I'll refute. And number two, that, well, it's not important anyway. There are much more other important things out there. We reject this, brothers and sisters, on the basis that we value our mother tongue. It's underpinning our culture, underpinning the way we got our religion, underpinning the future of our generations. In this debate today, there were three main areas of contention, I believe. Three main areas of conflict, and in fact, three main areas of debate. The first is whether our language is intertwined with our culture, and whether it has a connection to our community framework. Our side argued that language and culture are intertwined. When one goes, the other will also go. We cited the world's strongest authority on this subject, Dr. Fishman. We cited Sapir and Whorf. We cited Fishman and various others. The argument from them was, well, where is the evidence? Where's the empirical evidence? Well, I'm more than happy to email them over 1,000 pages of essays looking at anthropological studies. Did you know, by the way, there's a whole subject called anthropology? There's a whole subject called linguistics, looking at sociology, which looks at communities. We can look at the language of Cherokee, for example, and look at how that went and how the values in Native America went as a direct result. So there is a huge groundswell of information out there which tells us that when a language goes, a culture goes, its values goes as a direct result. In Gujarati, some sayings came to mind while I was there. One of them is Velo Kenche Murai Jai, which means children reap. That means that we go back to our roots at all time. Our community goes back to its root. And another one that is very important, which Ifat Aunty pointed to, which is Mautar Vave and Via Vade, which means children reap what their parents sow. Our part of the house on this side is not willing to risk our culture not continuing because we are not willing to risk the fact that our community's network would dilute. Sayada spoke very passionately about Gujarati being the common tongue of Khojas, linking Khojas from places like Mowa all the way to Minnesota, from Mumbai to Mombasa, etc. And I talked about it as well. If that thread of Gujarati goes from our community, then what have we left? What connects us to the community in Madagascar if we can't speak to them in the same language? They speak French, we speak English, and so on. The second main area of this debate, which was very important for us, was the idea of passing our madhab from generation to generation. And this, we feel, is the most critical point on our side of the house. We feel we cannot risk going against the wise words of Ayatollah Sayyid Sistani. And I gave you a direct quotation from him where he said the importance of mother tongue to preserve it so that the religion passes from generation to generation. I also gave you examples. I had none to the contrary, but I gave you examples of other Shia Ithna Ashari organizations, other diaspora of equal population that left India only the same time when our forefathers left, some 100, 150 years ago, and today they don't practice their religion. So when I'm asked what evidence is there, well, I've given you two evidences. I could have given you more. I could have talked to you about the Lawati community in Oman. I could have given to Khojas that went to Russia, Khojas that went to Iran. There are so many out there. I even told you about Khoja Wahhabis. It happens when you lose your language, you lose your culture, you lose your religion. And that is why we're not okay to risk that. That is why Gujarati must have a future. And the third point of contention is whether Gujarati has already passed its sell-by date. The proposition feel it's a lost cause. Why bother? There are more important things to focus on. Well, we feel that's too soft a way of handling things. We think if you want something, if you realize its value, then you do whatever it takes to maintain it. They feel Gujarati is a backward subject. Well, I'll tell them 60 million people speak Gujarati. The world's top business people speak Gujarati. We feel that Gujarati can be revived. It's failing a little bit in the West in our community, but it can be pushed and it can be revived. And I gave the example of Hebrew and Hawaiian and various other languages as well. And yes, Karar, it is also my dream that my children speak Gujarati. That is why today we disagree with you, because we believe Gujarati is the common thread that keeps our Khoja community united. We disagree because we know that a common language means, without a common language, we will lose our common culture. We disagree with your proposition because we know without our common culture, there's a strong chance that our religion may not pass from generation to generation. And we disagree because we understand that anything that helps our mother is something which we need to protect. That is why we believe we need to solidify our culture. We need to solidify our community structures, and we need to solidify our understanding of our language. And that is why we seek your support to oppose this motion.
Thank you very much to all the speakers. It truly has been amazing. Before we close up, can everyone get back onto Slido? I'm not sure if it's going to come up on the screen. But now you have the opportunity to vote. And the voting is slightly different this time. The question isn't based on your personal view, but the question actually is, which team was stronger in presenting their side of the motion? So now you're voting based on the teams, not based on your own personal view. So was it the proposition or was it the opposition? And we'll give you a minute to vote. Just to let you all know, this won't show up on the screen. The results will be given by Sheikh Noor right at the end. Yes, it's slido.com. That's slido.com. And the code is hashtag com, COMM spirit. Does that work? 30 seconds just to finish up voting. All right, perfect. Thank you, everyone. Thank you for voting, for getting involved, for speaking as well. And I'm quite sure I speak for everyone when I say it truly has been exhilarating and quite genuine, these debates. Sorry, guys. I'm just closing up now. So thank you to all of the speakers for taking your time out to prepare. You have done an amazing job, so thank you very much. And whatever the outcome of the debate is tonight, both teams have brought something to the mosque today, so thank you very much. And for that, let's have a salawat, please. Finally, thank you to our reviewers at the back who now have a very difficult decision to make, and we'll give them some time with that. And that's all from me. Thank you all very much for being a fantastic audience, and I'd like to pass back on to Sarah now. Thank you.
I have to say, that was amazing. Okay, thank you so much for all the participants who agreed to take part in this debate. You've put in a lot of effort in researching the topic and delivering your arguments. And I'm really sure that the judges are gonna have a really hard time judging this. Also, if anyone isn't comfortable with pictures going up on social media, please let me know personally. For now, I'm just gonna call Siptain Uncle to come forward and give us a small talk on his research and findings.
وَلَا حَوْلَ وَلَا قُوَّةِ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ الْعَلِيِّ الْعَظِيمِ Brothers, sisters in Islam, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I think this particular debate was passionately conducted, and I think both the sides made their points extremely well. But I think the title itself gives away quite a nice core message in which it says that the Khoja mother tongue doesn't have a future. I just want to add, if we choose not to have it. So basically, I think that should be the understanding. If we choose not to have it, then we would not have the future of our mother tongue. Now, the Koja mother tongue, what are they? Fundamentally, the Koja mother tongue are three, Gujarati, Kachi, and Sindhi. 93 million people speak these three languages. 26th language is Gujarati. 700,000 people residing in UK speak Gujarati. So these languages, which we call Koja mother tongue, are languages which are kicking and alive. So we need to make it alive by kicking it and make it alive within our community. When we reflect back historically, 60 years ago in the Koja community, we numbered 100,000. 100% of our community members spoke Gujarati. 100% of our community understood Gujarati. And the majority of us knew how to write it. Today, 76% understand and speak Gujarati, and less than half write Gujarati. So all is not lost. I did a research in the Awakening Project on identity and language. And you know what? Age 40, majority of people who responded, age 40, considered their mother tongue, Gujarati and Kachi, is very important. And less than 40 years of age, these are 40 years of age who considered the mother tongue very important. Less than 40 years of age are regretting the fact that they are unable to pass their heritage and the language to their children only because the processes are not there in the community to pass it. That's the issue. Science tells us that there are four births in languages. Languages have births. The first birth is the cellular birth, where the mother's egg and the father's sperm meet. And that's the birth, which is known in the language science, cellular birth. At that time, there is a blueprint, genetic blueprint, which have evolved over the years, which communicates with the mother. The mother's hearing and the expression and the speeches are absorbed by that cellular birth, by those cells. That's what science tells us. So the next birth is the physical birth when the baby is born. And when the baby hears the sound, doesn't understand it, sees the sound, doesn't understand it, but baby sees and hears that and appreciates it. And when the baby becomes a child and he attends the school and he goes about his business, he then begins to understand the tonicity of the language, the anger, the respect. This is the emotional birth of a language in a child. And as the child grows up, and then he passes and crosses the boundary, the ethical boundary, the religious boundary, the culture boundary, he then adopts a social birth. And the science tells us that during the emotional birth and the social birth, we adopt other languages. But we dream in our mother tongue. We dream our happiness in our mother tongue. We dream or we cry our sadness in our mother tongue. Why? Because mother has given us birth. That's the connection of the mother tongue. You see, mother tongue keeps us alive. Actually, languages keeps us alive. I'm not against, by the way, I'm not against your propositions. I think that we should learn as many languages as we can. 100 years ago, 60 years ago, we spoke seven languages in our community. Today, our main language in the West is one, English. And Gujarati is only 76% speak it in our own communities in the West. So we are, all is not lost, but we have to understand the value of it. Our language keeps us alive. Our language keeps us moving. Our language keeps us knowledgeable. This is the power of language and words. As we move about in our experiences, we express our words in the language we understand, and we dream and cry in the language our mother gives us. So finally, in Gujarati, I want to say that the biggest crisis in the 21st century is the identity crisis. And therefore, if you want to preserve your identity, char cheez ni zaroor. First, pehli vastu ye che ki hamesha tumhe tumhara palanhar ne koi dis bhulta nahi. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Jo tumhe ene bhuli gaya, to tumhe bhatakta rahi. You would not have a connection with your Lord. Biju vastu ki tumhe bhulwani nahi, ye tumhari maa. Hamesha dhyan yaad rakhjo ki maa jyare barth aape che ne, tyare je pyar aape che ne, ye chokro ke chokri ne, baby ne, ye je shabd use kare che ne, ye shabds are the first language matru bhasha thi ke che ne sathe vaat kare che. Ane bhulta nahi કે દુનિયામાં આજે તમને જો ખોડો ખપતો હોય ને તો ધ બેસ્ટ ખોડો એ માનો ખોડો છે. અને તમને શોલ્ડર ખપતું હોય ને કોઈના રોવા માટે, ધ બેસ્ટ શોલ્ડર ઇઝ ધ ડેડ્સ શોલ્ડર. બાપનો ખભો અને માનો ખોડો આર ધ બેસ્ટ ટુ થિંગ્સ ઇન ધ વર્લ્ડ. ધ થર્ડ થિંગ ઇઝ માતૃભાષા. વી હેવ ધ રિચ હેરિટેજ ઓફ અવર લેંગ્વેજ. ગુજરાતી, Kachi are our languages. Why do we want to give it up? Why should we give it up? We can learn and we can act out in the best possible way and adopt a different culture. Even then, the person of that culture will ask you, but who are you? And if you don't understand your heritage, you will not be able to explain what your background is. And finally, the fourth thing, Matru Samaj. માતૃ સમાજનો મતલબ કોમ્યુનિટી. કોઈ દિવસ કોમને તમે ભૂલવાનું નહીં. આ કોમ તમને પરણાવે છે, આ કોમ તમને દફનાવે છે, અને આ કોમ તમને ઉભા કરે છે. આઈ થિંક વિથ દેટ યુ આર ઓલ ઇન્ટરેસ્ટેડ ટુ હિયર મોર. નો, આઈ થિંક આઈલ એન્ડ હિયર બીકોઝ આઈ એમ ઓન્લી ગિવન 7 મિનિટ્સ. સો અસ્સલામુ અલયકુમ વ રહમતુલ્લાહ.
Thank you for that. So finally, the results. So tell me, if you feel like the opposing side, the participants that were on the side of the Khoja mother tongue does have a future, is going to win, can I get a show of hands? Oh, this is interesting. Okay, I'm not going to reveal the results because I think there's no event complete in Birmingham without the contribution of our highly learned and skilled Sheikh Noor. So I'm going to call up Sheikh Noor to tell us who the winners are.
Sallallahu ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على محمد وآله الطاهرين اللهم صل على محمد. First, let's thank Almighty God for giving us these moments. No doubt this program has lifted the community spirit. We are all inspired and thrilled. Let's thank the organizers and recite one loud salawat for the organizers of this event. Thanks to Brother Kavim, Ali, and the sisters for organizing such a wonderful event. And I hope and pray we see more of such events in our community. My task is very simple and straightforward. It's not about majlis, masa'e, bagam, no. It's very simple and straightforward. It's to declare the result and to tell you who are the winners and what you guys have voted for. Although we have the veto power to overrule what you are. But before we do that, just a few comments from the reviewers of these wonderful events and debates. I think all the three of us are inspired. We've learned a lot from both sides. And there are a few points which were raised by both of them, which I feel it was amazing. I begin with my mom, Effat. You've encouraged us and you have outlined certain points on how to instill the love of mother's tongue. And I can see that in your daughter, Anissa. And of course, Sayyida Moti, you've done very well and you picked up the last part of my khutbah on Friday. It's not too late. We can still develop the language and it can still be lively. Thank you so much for that. And we picked up a point from Shen. Of course, you've been serving the community, so we expected that from you. The question of networking and your statistics were amazing. And I thought mentioning the support of Agassistani was indeed one of the best things you've done tonight. Because we are all Mukalladin of Agassistani. Now to Muhammad Abbas, the deputy head of our madrasa. I thought you were going to propose that there should be Gujarati in the madrasa. Isn't it Faisal? We need some Gujarati classes. But I thought, inshallah, I thought you've done exceptionally well by taking us back to some references to dictionary. I think it's amazing, and I like that. But the best of all is Somaya Hemraj. You were not emotional. You were calm, articulate, very clear. We really loved the way you presented it. Thank you so much. And of course, Brother Karrar, there was a point you raised, which to me is a key point here. Why we do not have Gujarati in MCE program, Madrasa Center of Excellence. If you go to Aga Khan, they've got some sentiment of where they are coming from within their setup. And most especially the Bukharis. Madrasa Center of Excellence is one world curriculum which we are to introduce, which we are expecting all the madaris to accept, so that when a child is to move from Kenya to, say, London, he should be able to continue. So I thought that was an amazing point. And also there was a point you counter Shen, where you said it is exceptional, or you counter our mom, Effat. In your case, it's exceptional. You did very well in your house. But most of the families, are they into that? More work to be done, inshallah. And this is my general personal comment. I think there's a paper which one? Okay, the paper is here. Mother tongue as a place within the religion of Islam. It has a place. And Quran sanctioned it. But the question is, what is mother tongue today? Most of you are British and you carry British passports. Can that be perceived as mother tongue English because you're British? What is mother tongue? So we'll need our uncles, Panjwanis, to, in the next program, inshallah, to explain and expound more on what is mother tongue. But in Quran, there is a general discussion that mother tongue cannot be ignored. And beautifully, Shen mentioned chapter 30, verse 22. One of the signs of Allah is that he blessed you with tongue. Tongue here means language, mother tongue. So that is very, very important. And there's also another verse in Quran, 49 verse 13, and I think Sayyida also mentioned, we created you of different tribes and nations. So the tribes and nation is referring to mother tongue. So it is there in Islam that you cannot ignore your mother tongue. Even the Holy Prophet of Islam, when he was moving from Mecca to Medina, he kept on saying, I'm forced to move from Makkah to Medina, or else I would love my mother place, which is Makkah al-Mukarrama. So therefore, it has a place. And there is no doubt about that. Okay? But in the same way, we encourage you, you cannot ignore your mother tongue. Although little has been done about it. Mr. Karrar beautifully mentioned, if you go to Dar es Salaam, or Tanzania, or even Nairobi, What are the languages there? I mean, I know of many communities that we have in the world today, no any other language is allowed on member except English. And I even approached some of those communities before. So therefore, these are my suggestions. If we truly want to build the mother tongue, I will come to the opposing side also. It begins from home. Life is too fast today. Certain things are beyond your control. You can try, but there are laws in place in each and every country. You have to begin at a very early age when the children are young. If you truly want to teach them their mother tongue, which is very, very important. I'm standing here. I'm from Ghana. I speak about 8 languages. I speak my mother's tongue because bilingual has more advantage than monolingual. And it has been proven. Those who are bilingual, they are sharp in mind than those who are monolingual. This has been proven. Hence, there is a German philosopher who said that if you know one language, you do not know even that language. It's very, very important because it makes you sharp. You are able to pull resources from different angles altogether. But look at our majalis. It's in Urdu. Are you Urdu? World Federation, is it Urdu? Koyej, is it Urdu? It begins there. If you truly, as community, we want to develop and grow, it begins from us. You bring a Gujarati speaker, how many people will sit? At least the old people will sit, but the young ones will not come. So it begins from our community and it begins from home. That's number one. So maybe we need to review our majlis. Somebody was telling me, Shaku, no, you will lose your job. I said, I will be happy. I will welcome that. So long as we have to strengthen the language for good purpose and positive, why not? I speak my mother tongue. And then, of course, number two, I think this should go to Koyej, Africa Federation, World Federation. If you truly want to develop this language, there should be some sort of translation work. Children's book. How many children's books do today we have in Gujarati, in our communities? So you can't blame those who are opposed by saying that it has no future. Future, is it social? Is it spiritual? Is it political? Is it educational? Why do you mean by future? So that's number two. That's my suggestion. We need to have some small, you know, our elders who know the language, translate some good Islamic books for children. So the children, as young as they are, we teach them. They will never get confused. I study many languages at the same time. Like my children today, I speak to them. Sometimes Ashanti, sometimes Hausa, sometimes English. So many languages I speak. And the child will never get confused because at this age, the child will be able to develop it properly. So number two is the translation work, which I will suggest, inshallah, Shen. And number three, classes. Today we are having classes, but if you look at who attend the class, it is elderly people attend the class. We need to make it attractive. Make them love it. You cannot force it on them. But definitely, what I want to say, mother tongue as a place within the religion of Islam, and we cannot ignore it. And lastly, when we discuss mother tongue, what are we talking about? Because we are told a person who knows his mother tongue is attached to his culture and value. What is the culture? I'm speaking from my heart. And I think I'm the best person to speak because I've been with Hoja for some good number of years. And today I've got the best friends in the world are Hojas. One thing I can tell you, whether you agree or not, the most organized Shia community outside countries like Iran and them is Hoja community in the world. Salli ala Muhammad. They're well organized. That's why when I came here, you know, when I came, some people were telling me, Sheikh, are you able to settle? Do you know Hojas? I said, Baba, if you know one Hoja, you should be able to know. It's the same. But then the values we are talking about, the culture we are talking about, apart from it keeping you together, which is amazing, is exceptional. And we have to thank Allah for that. the amount of work the organizations are doing, the federations and them, are just amazing. And this is as a result of keeping that identity of Khoja. Those who have left their identity, you don't see any progress really in terms of coming together, in terms of having Imam Bara. I know of many parents, when their daughters and sons go to study anywhere, the first thing they ask, do we have Jamaat there or not? So this is very, very important. But there's a very important question. I want to keep it with you, Shan, Sayyid, all those who are in the key positions of community, the chairmen and the secretaries of our community. When we talk of the values, if I learn my mother tongue, what value are we talking about? What culture are we talking about? One thing I know of the biryani, the kichiros. This is where it has remained. I think we need to teach them more of those values. I think we only talking about it, but the values, I don't see. When I go to Africa, I see African values in them more than the way I see the Khoja values in them. When I come here in the UK, I mean, you will tell me, I see the English in a person more than that. So I think it's our duty, the duty of the management of our communities, to ensure that we bring some of the texts of the language on board and teach people. Finally, having said the language is important, mother tongue, you cannot ignore it. It makes you proud that you speak additional language. We cannot forget the place we live in. It is no excuse to live in this country or wherever you are and you do not know the language of that country. Today, when you are forced to produce document, you will say, I'm British, and you are proud of being British. So you have to also uphold British value. And one of the value of Britain is to know the language. When I was coming here, I had to go to British Council to sit for an exams. Four types of exams. And for each exam, you have to get same mark. And you can ask students who are coming here to study. You must know the language. So what I'm trying to say, I encourage you. I encourage myself. As we're trying to work on our own mother tongue, which is a progressive thing. It will not happen overnight, but we cannot also forget the importance of British value. And you remember there was a time here, the country said, those who are here and they don't know English, they may be asked to go out. Let's learn that value also. And by so doing, we'll be able to develop the best of the community. So inshallah, I'm waiting for Sayyid and them teach us other values, other cultures. Like if you ask me my country, my language, I will tell, okay, Mendi, she means Mendi. The Islam sanctions cultures if they are not against the teachings of Islam. Like the Holy Prophet, he was proud to be an Arab. He promoted cultures which were in line with the teachings of Islam. Same way, I'm throwing it to all of you, especially to the elders. Bring us something of that culture which we can share with people on the member to attract the young ones in loving the thing. But I know it's a process. It will not happen now. We'll take it long. Now the final, the result of this debate. Where is the... Okay. Okay. They said I must do it professionally. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. This is the structure of results. Number of votes casted in the House today is 150. Good attendance. Members of the audience, present today voted in against the motion, which states the House believes the Khoja mother tongue has no future. So they are with Shane and his group. They support him. Those who voted in favor of the motion, 30%. And those who voted against the motion, 70%. Ah, mashallah, you swallow the mashallah. The reviewers have come to an unanimous decision which overrules the voting of the audience. And so I hereby declare the motion, this House believes the Khoja mother tongue has no future, to be accepted. Now we have.
Can we just say there were no envelopes exchanged?
The special cookie crumble galaxy. Okay, now come. But you have to give me some.
Definitely. I'm too fat to eat any.
Okay, now we're going to recite Dua al-Wahda. Dua al-Wahda. So if you hold each other's hand, it's good. Let's all together, inshallah. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. La ilaha illallah. إلها واحدا ونحن له مسلمون لا إله إلا الله ولا نعبد إلا إياه مخلصين له الدين ولو كره المشركون لا إله إلا الله وحده 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 أنجز وحده ونصر عبده وأعز جنده وهزم الأحزاب وحده فله الملك وله الحمد يحيي ويميت ويميت ويحيي وهو حي لا يموت بيده الخير وهو على كل شيء قدير.
Last but not least, before I tell you about food, I know you're waiting for this. Sugra, can I please ask you to come forward to just make a quick announcement?
Assalamu alaikum. This will only take a minute. I am extremely excited to announce to you that Bain is starting a book club for anyone aged 15 years and above in collaboration with the other Shia communities, the Iraqi Center, the Husseiniya, and the Iranian Center. The book club will run for 3 months, and the idea is to read a book for 3 to 4 weeks and then meet up and have a discussion about the contents of the book. Because, alhamdulillah, we are blessed to have our Sheikh Noor with us, he will be present at these sessions to share his insights, inshallah. We will launch the book club on Sunday, March 5th at 7 p.m. and invite you all to attend this launch event where we will start our reading journey with a discussion by Sheikh Noor about the importance of reading and how to read effectively. Apart from that, we will also get feedback from you all about what books you'd like to read and what timings you'd like to have in discussion circles. On that day, we will also be distributing copies of the first book we'll be reading. We look forward to going on this journey of growth with books and igniting the passion of reading in our communities with as many of you as possible. So if you have any questions, please do come speak to me, Sister Sabiha, or Brother Kazim. And I really hope to see you all on Sunday, inshallah. Thank you.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, uncles and aunties, brothers and sisters, on behalf of the organizers, I would once again like to thank you so much for your attendance for tonight. You've been a lovely audience, I have to say. And now, in proper Khoja tradition, perhaps some of you have been so patient, we know that there's no Khoja event without food. Please make your way to the back where Birmingham's most delightful pizzas will be served. Wait, I have to add one thing. These events are only possible with all your moral and financial support. So I would really request you if you can donate towards the running of our future programs and this one. There are donation tins at the back, so feel free. Thank you so much for today.